Yeah, actually, I wanted to mention on these retreats, well, we try and keep external things to minimum, but we do want to talk to you a little bit about supporting the Buddhist Center online, if possible. These retreats we've been doing now for over 2 years since the pandemic began, and I'll post to the chat in a minute the link to the archive of retreats, so you could just go and do any of the home retreats that have happened in the last couple of years. And basically, we need supporting. The Buddhist Center Online runs on donations, and people are very generous when they sign up for these retreats and other events. But many of the events don't really pay for themselves, and we basically want to stick with the model of Dana. We don't want to start charging ticket prices for events. So if you can, if you're the sort of person who's in a position, despite the cost of living crisis and all the pressures that we face economically, if you're the sort of person who can help support our work, then I will post a link in a second, and it will basically support people like Paramananda, Bodhilila, Yashobodhi, many other people who teach on our site to continue working, and it will support our team to continue putting on these kinds of events. So thank you for considering that. We basically are here to serve you, to serve the community, and we hope in a way it's helped the whole thing is owned and held communally. That's one of our key values. So that's your little commercial break over. And I'm going to hand over to Paramananda, who's probably going to try and sell you Coca-Cola or something.
Okay. Hello, everybody. Morning. Well, I hope you're doing all right with how we are with the retreat and enjoying it, or at least feeling some benefit from it. I've had this going round in my mind over the last week, so we'll have it. It's not quite a poem, it's a song, which I'm sure some of you will know. I'm not going to sing it, I'm just going to recite it if I can remember it. From Leonard Cohen's song. I was always a big fan of Leonard Cohen. And I was quite sad when he died, really. It's quite interesting, isn't it? I probably first heard Leonard Cohen when I was, I don't know, 13 or something. And, quite often, most of the people I liked when I was young, you grow out of, don't you? But I never grew out of Leonard Cohen. And of course, he came back and did some very interesting music in his later years. And of course, was a Buddhist, wasn't he? Spent quite a long time in a Buddhist monastery, Zen Buddhist monastery in America. Anyway, here's one of his most famous, really, I think, certainly of his early work. This is a bird on a wire. Like a bird on the wire, like a drunk in some midnight choir, I've tried in my way to be free. Like a worm on a hook, like a knight from some old-fashioned book, I've kept all my ribbons for thee. And if I have been unkind, I hope you can just let it go by. And if I have been untrue, I hope you know it was never to you. Like a beast with its horn, like a baby stillborn, I've torn everyone who reached out for me. But I swear by this song and all that I have done wrong, I will make it up to thee. I saw a beggar leaning on his wooden crutch. He called out to me, You must not ask for so much. A pretty woman leaning in a darkened door cried out, why not ask for so much more? Like a bird on a wire, like a drunk in some midnight choir, I have tried in my way to be free. It's a little bit of a theme, isn't it? I've talked a little bit about the Buddha comparing his teachings with the taste of the ocean, this idea that all his teachings had the same taste out of freedom, you know. So I mean, I think it's kind of worth bearing that in mind when you meditate. Yeah, it's a practice that's meant to support our liberation. And of course, there's different dimensions of liberation, isn't there? There's a kind of internal liberation, a freeing of ourselves. And then there's a corresponding but not necessarily related social or political liberation. And I think a lot of what we get this idea, you know, a lot of what we're maybe concerned about these days or beginning to feel the tension of our life and the life of the planet, aren't we? We're being brought up more into this. Well, it's a conflict, isn't it, perhaps? A conflict between a kind of human wants and so much needs. It's more, well, in some places, of course, it is very much needs, but in our culture, it's more about our wants, isn't it? And that consequence for the wider social and ecological consequences of the way we live our lives. There's this kind of tension, perhaps, for many of us, isn't it? I know myself, I often feel I'm inadequately engaged or active in the world, you know. But I also think it's kind of a forced dichotomy, really, because I think one of the things I want to try and emphasize these days as a meditation teacher, that actually our practice is always engaged. You know, when we meditate, it is a practice of engagement in and of itself, yeah. Or it's a deepening of a realization that we're always intimately involved in the world, even when we're sitting still, sitting quietly and just trying to be still. In fact, what we're really trying to do in a way is to deepen this intimacy with the world, because our body, our psyche, our being is never separate from the world. I mean, this is one of these core teachings of Buddhism, isn't it? Of interpenetration, interdependence, that everything is woven together. And this much of our neurotic want are actually based on a feeling that we don't fully experience this, you know. We experience ourselves as basically discrete and separate. Quite often we experience the world as something quite hostile and difficult. And maybe a lot of consumerism is really based on trying to undermine a person's feeling of well-being, and not making that into some kind of conspiracy theory. But of course, you know, it's well documented that there was a sort of radical change at some point in American culture that then spread everywhere. But actually, it was Freud's nephew, was it? Who sort of invented advertising in America and sort of realized that you could, up until a certain point, manufacturers, made what people needed. Yeah, that people need a shovel, people need a bucket, people need roof and felt. But they made it, whatever it was, they made it. And at some point, based on the work of Freud, someone had the insight that actually you could stimulate wants rather than fulfill needs. And this really is what we've done, isn't it? Our culture's really, I mean, if you look around, how many of us look around at how many clothes you've got, or, you know, how much cutlery, or, you know, we've all got an enormous amount more. Well, I say all, I shouldn't say all, some of you might be living a very simple life indeed, but, you know, most of us in our culture, generally speaking, have this huge amount of possessions, yeah, in comparison. Of course, rich people have for many always had a lot more than they needed, haven't they? Why am I saying this? Okay, so from a meditation point of view, you're not trying to kind of, I don't think you're trying to fix something that's wrong with you. And there might be things wrong with you that you want to fix, and there might be other avenues to engage with that, you know, I don't know. No comment on that, but I think what we're trying to do primarily as meditators is to allow ourselves to experience how we are deeply supported by and embedded in reality itself. That your own body, of course, is your own body, your own mind is part of something much bigger than you, isn't it? You're kind of manifesting in the world. The world is manifesting you. You're an expression of, and this way of relaxing, it's kind of, this is kind of, this came up a little bit, I think, in the Q&A thing yesterday, you know, what we're trying to do is just to relax into what's actually there, you know, what our true nature is. And our true nature is no different from the true nature of everything else. That, you know, we're an arising and passing away like everything else in the world. And we're intimately connected. And it's kind of remembering, you know, meditation gives us an opportunity to remember this, you know. In a funny sort of way, I think it can take a lot of pressure off us. When we remember ourselves in this sort of way, Perhaps I need to assert ourselves in the world. I need to try and manipulate the world. Lessened, you know. I mean, I'm not advocating inactivity here, because that, as I said, I think it is also very important that we engage in the world in whatever way we can, in a useful sense, in a positive sense. But in order to do that, I think it's very hard, I think, to act in the world in this way unless we have a loving sense of ourselves, isn't it? Sort of basic Buddhism, isn't it? We've got to have a sense of ourselves as something of worth, for us to really care about the world. Anyway, you all know this sort of thing, don't you? I suppose on a sort of practical level, I'm trying to encourage us not to think of meditation as kind of disappearing somewhere. I think sometimes meditation can be a bit like disappearing into a kind of private world, you know. Our experience is sort of reinforces the separateness, so we don't want to meditate in a way that reinforces our sense of being separate, you know, or somehow different. Well, of course we are all different, aren't we? That's fine, but Anyway, let's do some practice together. Get yourself comfortable. We'll spend a little bit of time working with our posture. One of the things we can get into as meditators is kind of grabbing a practice, and actually it's always worth just spending time. Feeling into. Take your time just to, even if you don't have much time to meditate in your life, maybe normally you have quite a busy life and it's quite hard to sit much. Then kind of grab a practice, you know. Try and sort of find a way of coming into a practice that takes in the actual situation that you're in, that you're sort of sensitive to, both the internal situation, how you're feeling, also the external situation, where you are, some sense of the world, the context in which we are manifesting in, the context of not only our own personal lives, but more broadly, the sense of the world itself, whatever that might mean. Start with having a sense of the distance between the crown of your head and the ceiling of the room you're sitting in. and for kind of imaginative remembering, that's to have a sense of the sky above. An old word for the sky was the marvelous. The marvelous. We just see if we can allow that sense of the openness and vastness of what's above us have whatever effect it has, yeah, just to be sensitive, just to see if you can let it kind of activate you. And sky always implies earth, doesn't it? Earth and sky imply one another. But with a sense of the sky above you, you can remember first through the physical contact with, and again, more imaginatively, you can remember the earth below you. We try and have a sense of making the posture, this idea that the posture is a kind of ongoing element within the meditation. We don't, sometimes we can think, oh, we just get the posture right, then we forget about it. It's not quite like that, I don't think. The posture is an ongoing opening. Got this basic sort of energetic dynamic in the body where we're trying to let go in the legs and sort of release the pelvis, and maybe even imagine the pelvis kind of falling open a little bit, the hips and the groin releasing a little bit. Legs are releasing. Aquin gives us this lovely image. He says, when we meditate, we can imagine that we're sitting in a warm bath of fragrant flowers and the medicinal herbs that's sort of coming up to our waist, there, coming up to our hip. This image of the lower body really softening and releasing. However you sit, you need to find a way of sitting that at least potentially allows you to fully release in the legs and the thighs. This is why we never sit with our legs up, with our sort of knees off the ground. Won't be able to release fully if you sit like that. If you have to or want to sit like that, you need to put something under your legs so you can, you're not engaging the muscles to hold the legs. where you can sit, imagine you're sitting in this warm bath. Letting your legs relax. Making a kind of sensuous connection with the earth and your imagination, perhaps an energetic connection with the earth, whatever that might mean. And at the other end, we're releasing the head upwards, aren't we, towards the sky. The posture becomes a joining of earth and sky through the body itself. This is the image of the tree, isn't it? Reaches up and down, open to the nourishment of the earth and the light, the nourishment of the sun. Our physical spine, haven't we, that we should remember, it's not just bone, but soft tissue, fluid, an impulse, electrical impulse, energy. It's connecting your skull with your pelvis. So, and try and allow yourself to imagine your skull in relation to your pelvis. And just notice what's happening in that relationship as you breathe in and out. And shoulders relax. We're looking for a felt experience, not worry too much about the idea, but just trying to feel into how that spine snakes up through the body, giving this vertical structure. Of course, it's not straight, it's gently curving through the body. It's alive with energy, connecting us up. Your face relaxed. Go into the mouth, if you like, the interior of your mouth. Get a little bit of a sense of the interior of the body through the mouth. And, you know, kind of moist. Living. Ideally, just have your tongue sort of press gently upwards, sort of flattened against the roof of the mouth. It's known as the magpie bridge in the Chinese Taoist tradition. God is a very important kind of energetic connection in the body. Get the alignment of the nose and the navel, maybe seeing if just dropping the nose towards the navel feels like it's lengthening the back a little bit. Ears above the shoulders, shoulders above the hip. Okay, there's only so much we can do about posture, sort of consciously. At some point, we just have to sort of trust in the breath and the body's ability to sort of realign itself if we relax. Simply because our habitual holdings were still normal to us, you know, if we habitually hold someone. But if you do notice some kind of holding, you can just gently put your awareness on the surface of the skin where the holding is. If you breathe in and out, just awareness kind of come into the body there a little bit. But we're just sort of not quite right, is it? I hesitate. So I don't. Language is a funny thing, isn't it? It's not really putting our awareness there, it's just sort of recognizing what feeling is there, you know, or allowing there to be awareness there, if that makes sense. Soften the parts of the body that will soften, hands, soles of the feet, the face. This softening is also noticing the sensitivity and energy in that part of the body. So it's not a kind of dull or numb. So our hands can be at the same time relaxed but feel very alive. We're looking for this sense of relaxed aliveness in the body. In particular, we're looking for really allowing the body to be responsive to our breath. Not in an exaggerated way, but just really feeling how the breath, how the diaphragm is moving, how the rib cage is moving, how the back of the body broadened. I find that really quite a nice feeling, just to notice how the scapulars, the shoulder blades, what happens when you breathe in and slightly sort of separate away from the spine, and then you breathe out, they sort of drop back towards the spine a little bit. There's a bit of, it's subtle but certainly noticeable movement there, rather pleasant and enjoyable. So we're always interested in finding something enjoyable in the feeling of the body breathing. And even the idea or the sense of breathing, something breathing in at you and all this oxygen that the trees and the grass and the vegetation is producing. We're participating in the atmosphere of the world, aren't we? An active participant in the creation of the world just by breathing in and out. Face relax a bit more, yeah. Unlock the jaw. Maybe just a very little bit of movement in the jaw as you breathe in and out. As you breathe in, you might just sort of not a physical movement, but just the feeling of relaxing the chin down a little bit. Opening up the top of the jaw a little bit. In breath, natural tendency for that to close a little bit on the out breath. Don't worry about it, but just notice you get a bit of freedom. We're looking for a bit of freedom in the jaw as we breathe in and out. You know, this idea of drawing up from the root, in breath, and releasing down from the crown all the way down in the out breath. So we've got this nice serpentine breath, energetics. But we're taking our time here because this is, in a way, I think, the sort of fundamental move that we're trying to encourage in meditation, is a movement into direct experience, you know? Felt experience, as opposed to our ideas about experience. Attempts to organize it in a particular way or sort of master it in a particular way. We're just trying to give that part of us a bit of a rest, that we don't have to be having opinions or making plans, scheming, worrying about ourselves all the time. We can just enjoy the breathing body, part of the natural breathing world. Enjoy ourselves on an energetic, this opening, this sensuous engagement, the basic life, the Zoe, life force. Rising in the spaciousness around you, in the spaciousness of the world and beyond. There's always something very simple and direct we can be engage with when we meditate, other than our thoughts and our concerns. Plenty of time for that and the rest of the time. Or your clever thinking or whatever it is you get up to. Your body will then start to provide you with nourishing images, perhaps, pleasant sensations, maybe, sense of relaxing and opening. Your elbows towards the earth a little bit. Well, that really depends how you've got your hands. But a bit of a notice of the back of your body. Belly moving, your chest, your back, the legs relaxing, the spine swaying, the tide of the breath. Face softening. Releasing down the buttock. Might be some little sensation. Yeah, touching the nostrils. Well, depending how you, in the Zen tradition, we have it between the thumbs, this very delicate little sensation. It might just be a sensation below the navel, the dirty end. It just naturally becomes a sort of little focus in this openness. It's a very delicate sensation that's sort of just there in it. Open awareness with the whole body and the whole world. And why if that doesn't not happening for you, but could be anywhere, but I'd say traditionally it's quite often it's more, you know, just soften our wibbling nostrils, or just you've got the mudra with your hand, it's between your thumbs, it's very delicate little feeling. We write down in the perineum, little movement. You find yourself thinking a lot, just imagine activating the heart, sending a sense of love, that part of yourself that's thinking, doing all that thinking stuff. compassionate love. Real assurance. Plenty of time to worry or plan later. Just now, just breathing in a breathing world. So just notice what's happening now. Background still moving, lungs still filling and emptying, heart and the blood still happening on it. The room is still happening, the world is still happening, the sky is still above you. The earth is still below you. All of this arises in your consciousness quite naturally. Not obscured with the hyperactivity of thinking mind, a little bit of hype cognitive. Very useful, but now and then we can let go of it a little bit, can't we? So, as of our routine, just in your own time, making a transition to resting. Time for a little rest. Thank you. just laying still a little bit longer as you recollect yourself. Try and remember yourself to your heart, your legs, to your pelvis, arms to your shoulders, head to your spine there. Heart and your lung complex there, your core of you, in the middle, the center, the body kind of remember itself or oscillate around the heart area. And this time when you move back to sitting, just notice how the heart change in position. Moving in space. Just make that transition as calmly as possible. Without rush. Fuss. Coming back to our sitting posture. Take our seat with a sense of care. Right from the beginning, this couple of breath involved in the setting up of the posture. Some sensibly less human part of yourself, if we can use that terminology, the animal of yourself. Whatever way offers itself to you, just a sense of setting yourself up in the world, in relationship to maybe you can hear some birds or some noise. Aware of your environment as it offers itself to you, even if it's the traffic or whatever. The sense of the internal world of your body, your feelings, your thought, the external world. Senses, all of them arising equally in the spaciousness of your awareness. Not entirely extroverted or entirely introverted, just some kind of balance between what we experience as outer and inner. And knowing that both the outer and the inner are equally arising in awareness. or imagine the center, the awareness has any center. Moves out from the heart center rather than the head, maybe. The heart field. The way in which our heart is aware of the world, like another sense, it's aware of the electromagnetic energy of the world quite directly. This isn't a fantasy, it's just how it is. Our hearts respond to the life force of things, the energetics of things. The real sense in which we can open our hearts to the world, the real sense in which our hearts sense, engage in the world. You get that feeling of someone behind you or something, that's the heart picking up the energetics of another living thing. When you walk through a wood and find your heart relaxing, it's the heart being held by the energetics of that wood, that landscape. Gently taking your posture. You might like to remember Buddha sat under the Bodhi tree and was assailed by the forces of Mara. He just extended love. Heart force of love. Well wishing. Our basic methodology. Not an idea so much as a felt, energetic response. Legs release, our pelvis settle your spine, stretch and yawn in your body, opening, releasing, waking up. Relax, alertness, and let your self being nourished by the world, just the air and the light, whatever it is. Use the posture and the breath for stability, so we provide a kind of foundation in which we can depend upon breathing body. We get lost in our own thoughts, we can just very gently open up. Remember, our body in the body of the world. Don't try and shut down your thinking mind, that won't work. Just sort of let it be on the periphery, not right at the center of things. This goes on if it needs to go on. You don't have to take too much notice of it. You don't have to over-identify with your thoughts. They're just thoughts. They're just a form of sensation, a more abstract form. It's what we do with sensation, sense and sensation. We meditate, we don't have to make anything of our thoughts particularly. They can just arise and pass away like everything else. We don't have to push them away. Say something kindly to them. I know you're trying to help or keep me safe or whatever it is you're up to, but it's all right. I'm just happy to sit here breathing for a while. You don't have to worry. Of a real engagement, but it's not a cognitive engagement, it's fuller, more all of you engaged. Skin and your muscles and your organs and your bones, all of you engaged, your digestion, your breath. But it's all just happening, isn't it? It's all happening. You think it's static and permanent, but it's all just happening each moment. you're doing a lot of thinking, try just in your head or releasing your leg, if you can. Come a bit more into alignment. Imagine your body expressing you fully in this moment. What is being sufficient in this moment? but just noticing what's happening. Notice and relax. Okay, we're slightly over budget. Slightly over time. So I'll let you go and hopefully see you this afternoon, 3:30. Have a nice day, evening, whatever it is. Bye for now. Bye.